moving to de minimis. De minimis, we saw de minimis before. De minimis is a very popular topic. Cited in note 12F. And it has a general rule, and it has a bunch of exceptions. And unfortunately, customs has tested both on the general rule and on exceptions. So, but not to a high degree of specificity as customs examiners did on other free trade agreements. So, if you get the general rule. And you practice through, and you go through the practice of some of the de minimis questions related to NAFTA, I think you'll be fine. So let's talk about de minimis. So you have a 7% rule, generally speaking. That's a general rule. Of course, 7% what? If you have 7% value and 7% weight, that's for textiles. And this is for non-textiles. Should say non-textiles. All right, so let's look at the details. Let's see how examiners test on this. So value, and here we're talking about transaction value. You do not, and why do you need de minimis? Remember, to qualify the product, it has to be originating. And part of the originating formula, if you have something which is not 100% of NAFTA countries, then you have a problem. One way you can resolve the problem is you can apply that very last note, U, I believe, where it provides a laundry list of items which are de facto originate if they are brought into the NAFTA country and then re-exported to another NAFTA country. But very often you have to deal with the concept of tariff shifting. And tariff shifting in NAFTA has two sources. First of all, you have to determine if tariff shifting is applicable to in originating criteria under general note 12T. Next, you have to go to the part 102, which deals with marking, and figure out if it qualifies for marking. And if it qualifies for both, only then you can say, okay, this product qualifies for NAFTA country of origin. But sometimes the material is so small that you do not need to think about tariff shifting in the first place. And this is when de minimis rule comes handy. Because if it's below 7%, generally speaking, of value if it's non-textile, of weight if it's textile, then you're pretty much in good shape and you do not need to go through that tedious process of tariff shifting, for one thing. And for another thing, you also, if customs examiners propose this question to you, it is a great time saver because tariff shifting takes much more time to figure, to analyze, rather than just straightforwardly applying the de minimis rule. All right, so if non-NAFTA input product amounts to 7% or less of the transaction value, it qualifies for the de minimis and does not need to go through the tariff shifting. Let's see how it plays out on the customs broker exam. So, on November 26, 2008, the blended yarn, and customs examiners give you the HTS number at the heading level, a subheading level, consists of 95% cotton coming from Mexico, which is NAFTA, and 5% nylon fiber, also giving you the subheading number HTS from Taiwan, is imported from Mexico under this HTSUS. Subsequently, on November 27th, a post importation NAFTA claim is filed, should the 520D claim be allowed. So, customs examiners raised several interesting concepts in this particular question. All right, so let's break down the issues here. So first issue is, as you can see, the importation was made on November 26, 2008, but the NAFTA claim was not filed until almost 1 year thereafter, right? So the first thing to ask yourself is, do I qualify for NAFTA, right? Is it not too late, in other words, to file for NAFTA? And of course, that particular question, if you are too late to file, that's it, you're out of time. It's called statute of limitations. You have to move your feet quick enough, and customs examiners test your knowledge on this. The second, if you qualify, the second point of inquiry will be, is there tariff shifting or de minimis provisions or something else applicable? Because we see that we have Taiwanese nylon fiber, right? So this is the test. So let's go to the first topic of timing. Is it too late to file for preferential NAFTA claim? Recall that you cannot claim a NAFTA product unless you have a NAFTA certificate of origin. So if at the time of entry you don't have certificate of origin on hand, you cannot file the preferential treatment. Now, provided that you have it, then there comes timing. And this timing is clarified under 19 USC, this is the statute, 1520D. Sometimes it's called also, it is also the section 520, paragraph D of the Tariff Act. It is also provided for NAFTA, because the 520D, and hence you have that 520D post importation, sometimes you also have it provided in a regulation, although it is much less frequently cited. It is 19 CFR 1, section 181, which is a NAFTA, which is a NAFTA part, 31. Let's take a look at the regulation, and then we'll go to the statute. So, So you have a subpart D dealing with post-importation claims generally. So it has to be, here is a thing, refund in excess of duty. So the point of preferential duty claim is to get those excess of duties out, right? At any time within 1 year after that date of importation. So you have a day of importation. So you have day of importation. Plus 1 year. All right. Let's take a look at the statute, because statute is interesting too. Here is our statute, and here is that section D, which is a law, right? As you can see, it is not only applicable to NAFTA, but it is also applicable to the Korea, Colombia, Panama, Let's see. Peru, Oman, Chile. So a lot of free trade agreements qualify for the 520D claim, but there are the timing requirements too, right? So this provision has been applied very rigidly by customs lately. So customs, in other words, they reject the concept of filing a protest for the preferential duty claim. They say you must apply 520D application. Now, here is within 1 year after the date of importation. Here is the key. It has showed up on a customs broker exam time after time after time. So keep this in mind. Keep this rule in mind. And let's go back to the question. All right. So let's look at the dates here. So we have November 26, 2008, and we have November 27, 2009. So recall that day of importation plus 1 year. So day of importation is 11/26/08 plus 1 day. It will be 11/27/08, and plus 1 year. 1 day in 1 year, it would be 11/27/09. 11/27/09, November 27/09, is the last day you can make that claim. And on that very last day, it happens to be that the fact pattern shows the claim is made. So last day is fine, just like any other day. But it is there for the purpose, is to test your knowledge on a borderline. Is it too late or not too late? And here is when understanding of this post-importation duty refund claim time limitations becomes helpful. So the first prong is met. We are good on timing. So 520D allows us to file a post-importation NAFTA duty refund claim. We are not out of time. Great. What's the next step? Well, next we have to figure out whether or not you have to the non-originating component does not disqualify the product from NAFTA. So let's take a look. Let's start from in alphabetical order. So number one, the Taiwanese fibers of heading 55/06/10 fall outside of range of non-allowable changes in tariff classification, and therefore the claim should not be allowed. Well, let's take a look. So 55/06, I think we can, where is our search button? 55/06. Okay, no matches. How about this time? So I'm making a shortcut paragraph T inquiry, note 12T, 55. All right, so here we have chapter 55. We have 55. All right, so 55/06 falls into this rule, right? It's rule 1A under the chapter 55. So this question is not true because there is a range for allowable changes in the tariff classification. So we are not even at that percentage yet. We're just trying to figure out why this answer choice is incorrect. So as we saw in a general note 12T, we have the special provision which allows the change for that particular product. Next, so this one is not correct. There is a range, it doesn't fall outside the range. The claim should be allowed because the Mexican fibers predominate by weight, 95%. Therefore, the yarn originates under note 12BI as goods wholly obtained or produced entirely in territory of NAFTA party. So, paragraph BI in the general note 12, the customs examiner suggests is the way out, right? Or make a question mark. So, BI, wholly obtained and produced, because they are produced entirely in territory of Canada and Mexico. Here is a part. Entirely in territory of NAFTA parties, right? You can only qualify this, wholly obtained and produced entirely, if it is really entirely, right? But here, and we saw that wholly obtained and produced is a term of art. But entirely in the territory of NAFTA parties is not correct because you have something from Taiwan, right? So stuff from Taiwan negates this entirely clause, right? And therefore, you have a fact pattern and answer which contradict each other. And because they contradict each other, the B is not a correct answer choice. Let's move on to C. The claim should be allowed because it is within 1 year time frame. So we saw that it is within 1 year time frame. So I don't think my writing is well enough, but it should be 09. Within the time frame, so that's good, the check mark over here, and under de minimis rules of note 12F, right? So note 12F, de minimis rule, says the following. Let's see, A, B, C, D, E, F, G. All right, so here is the de minimis portion dealing with textiles. Chapters 50 through 63, 7% of the total weight of that component. It must be no more than 7% of the total weight of that component, then it can be disregarded. So here, oops, I think I closed by accident general note 12. Let me reopen it again. Okay. Oops. What is going on? Mm-hmm. Okay, like this. Makes it easier that way. All right, so de minimis rule 7%. How much percent do we have? We have 5%. So 5% is obviously less than 7%, making the de minimis rule applicable here. So it does originate, at least according to originate and the general note 12. They're not asking about marking, right? All right, so next. The claim should be allowed because the blended yarn is a specialty yarn of chapter 56 and requires only a single transformation span from within NAFTA territory. No, this is total nonsense. We saw in chapter 56 that there is a transformation requirement, right? But we really do not have that type of transformation here. We know we need to apply it. Well, first of all, we have no transformation, right? 5506, right, as far as HTS is concerned, right? So transformation is not gonna help, but de minimis does. So D is incorrect. E, this claim should not be allowed because the claim is outside the time frame. So as we saw, it is just on the border, it's just made it, right? It's the last day to file the claim, and the claim was filed, so we made it. Last day is just like any other day, right? You just have to be within the time frame, and we met that general rule, so we are good to go. So E is should be allowed, should not be allowed, negates this question, making C a correct answer choice.